Amazing grace, how sweet the sound, saved a wretch like me. For I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. The prodigal was welcomed home, the sinner now a saint. But the God who died came back to life, and everything is changed. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave. Death, where is your sting? Oh, fear, where is your power? The mighty King of Kings has disarmed you. Delivered and redeemed, eternal life is ours. Oh, praise his name forever. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from heaven's sweet embrace. I see your scars, your open arms, the beauty of your face. Through tears of joy, I lift my voice in everlasting praise. And on the day you call me in to heaven's sweet embrace, I see your scars, your open arms, the beauty of your face. Through tears of joy, I lift my voice in everlasting praise. Hallelujah. Christ is risen from the grave.
It's that time of morning where your eyes are still kind of adjusting to your surroundings and what's going on. I remember when I was hunting that you would oftentimes have these periods either early in the morning or late in the evening where you are up in the tree stand and you're looking around and the woods are pretty quiet, but your eyes kind of play tricks on you. You seem to see movement, maybe where it's just a leaf, you think it's an animal, and so your brain just starts working overdrive, trying to figure out what's going on around you. And as you do that, there's this combination of hope and fear. Even this morning, as I was looking down, I could barely see my vehicle in the at the bottom of the trailhead, and it looked like something was moving around my vehicle. I thought, oh man, somebody's messing with my car. There wasn't anything around, there's a bush down there. So, but this morning, as we are reflecting on the resurrection, it reminds me that there's this combination of hope and fear that takes place. Did you know that psychologists, as they study emotions and those kinds of things, have found that you have the same physiological response with hope and fear? I imagine that the resurrection produced a lot of hope and fear. Now, I went back and looked at our previous sunrise services as I was preparing for this morning. And it was interesting. The first Sunday, we were up on top of the Sandias there, and I was talking about hope and reflecting on hope of something new as we looked out over the city. That was in 2021, so we were coming out of the pandemic, and I think everybody was ready for something new. Well, the second Sunday, we were out on the west side, and it was 2022, and we were talking about how just strange the world was, how we kind of woke up to a new world over that last year, and how people were struggling and trying to find their place, and that in the resurrection, it produces a hope within us that's not built on ourselves, that we can't create the new world that we're looking for. Rather, we wait in hopeful expectation for it. So, as I was thinking about what we should share for this Sunday, I think for me, this Resurrection Sunday has been about the combination of hope and fear. Our scripture comes from the book of Acts. Now, Peter had been preaching, he'd been teaching, he'd seen God do amazing things, convert over 3,000 people in Jerusalem on that day of Pentecost. He had seen and been a part of the healings of God through the power of the Holy Spirit living in him. He had seen the fruits of the resurrection and the new world. But God was continually challenging their ideas of the world that had been rooted in their foundation. And so Peter is praying, and he receives a vision of a sheet of animals coming down. And he hears a voice that says, "Take and eat." And he says, "No, Lord, I've never eaten anything unclean," because the sheet was full of unclean animals. You know, those animals that that the Levitical law, that the Deuteronomic law, that these holiness codes had said, "Don't eat these things." And you hear this voice saying, "Take and eat." And Peter says, "No, I don't eat those things. I want to live my life in a way that pleases God." And then the voice says, "Don't call something unholy that I have made holy." And the resurrection was producing holiness in things that were once unholy. This story is being told in tandem with another story that was happening. There was a Roman centurion, a person who was in charge of a lot of soldiers, who was described as a God-fearer, somebody who respected the God of Israel, who prayed to the God of Israel, who gave money and attention to the things that were important to the God of Israel and to Israel itself. This Roman centurion had been taken captive in his heart by the one true God. And as he had lived this life, he received a visit from an angel. It's interesting, very, very, very much like Joseph, very much like Mary, very much like Elizabeth, and very much like Zechariah in the story of Jesus. This messenger comes to Cornelius and says, God has heard your prayers. And he said, call for a man named Peter and listen to what he has to say. And so this centurion knows what it means to follow orders. And so this is exactly what he does. And so while Peter's receiving this vision, he hears this knock down at the door. He's up on the roof. He hears the knock down in the bottom floor. And there's these three Romans looking for Peter. And they kind of are a little nervous about what's going on. Because remember, Jesus had just been crucified by the Romans. And while they were excited and passionate about the resurrection, they also understood something, that this was dangerous. So it would have probably produced a sense of fear in their life, a sense of anxiety, as the Romans knocked on that door and said, we're looking for a man named Peter. Now, Peter had also received a vision that there would be men that would come look for him. And they said, the messenger said, Peter, go with this person immediately. Well, it's interesting in the story, I find it says Peter went with them the next morning. And so I don't know, maybe he had to grill them, maybe he had a conversation with them, maybe he wanted to find out more. Whatever it was, it took a while for Peter to respond, at least through the night. Peter goes with them, but he also takes a group of believers with him. Maybe they had decided together that night that they would go with Peter. They didn't really understand what was going on, but that they would attend to God's business together. Maybe meeting death, maybe just experiencing something new. So they go to Cornelius's house. And Cornelius says, hey, we received this vision. This is why you're here, to tell us what God has planned for us, what message God has for us. And so Peter begins to recount the story of Jesus. I truly understand that God shows no partiality. That was interesting, because for Peter, the message of the gospel, the message of truth, the message of hope, the message of God's redemption was open to his people, but maybe not open to everybody. But Peter says, I think I get it now. God shows no partiality. But in every nation, the one who fears him and he does what is right and acceptable, the message he sent to the people of Israel, preaching peace by Jesus Christ, he's the Lord of all. That message spread throughout Judea, beginning in Galilee, after the baptism that John announced. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and with power. How he went about doing good and healing all who were oppressed by the devil, for God was with him. And we're just witnesses to all that he did, both in Judea and Jerusalem. They put him to death by hanging him on a tree, but God raised him on the third day and allowed him to appear, not to all people, but to us who were chosen by God as witnesses, and who ate and who drank with him when he rose from the dead. He commanded us to preach and to testify that he, the one he ordained by God as judge of the living and the dead. All the prophets testify about him, that everyone who believes in him receives forgiveness of sin in his name. Well, this message caused the stirring presence of the Holy Spirit And then Peter says, hey, let's bring some water in. Let's get these guys baptized. Who are we to withhold this from them? And we see that Cornelius's household is saved. Hope and fear. Two sides of the same coin. Now, hope and fear are experienced oftentimes as the same thing, but they do two very different things. Hope pulls one in towards something. Fear pushes one out, away from something. Both are physiologically experienced as a very similar emotion, but they do the exact opposite things. I imagine Peter had a lot of anxiety and anxiousness around not only going to a Roman centurion's house, but around what God was doing with the Gentiles. That this newness was producing a new world, a world where all nations could be called. What does this have to do with us? We look around our strange world, a new world, a world where the culture shifts have created an opportunity for fear or hope. And as our missionary said a few weeks ago, we can either draw in close to those or we can back away. And that produces within us a sense maybe of both fear and hope. Fear that we may not know what to say or understand what God is doing. Fear that they may not properly handle the truth of God. Fear that we might be rejected. Fear that that God would call us to places where we are quite out of place. But a hope that God could transform lives, renew people's spirits, change the course of families, bring hope and healing to the lives of men and women and children. We live in a world of hope and fear. The question is, which one will we lean into? Will we be drawn towards moving away, or will we be drawn towards leaning in? I believe that God is calling our church into a new life of ministry, one that calls us beyond our comfortable sanctuary, one that calls us out into wilderness areas, that calls us into streets and alleys, that calls us into homes and neighborhoods that are different, in hope and expectation that the resurrection will produce something new. That the hope and power of the new life of Jesus, that there's a taste of something new coming in the changed lives of people. I admit and confess that there are many times I'm fearful. And God knows that. But this fear is mixed with hope. And this Sunday morning, I'm being challenged. Which one will you lean into? Will you pull back or will you move in? The resurrection this morning challenges us to hope that something new could take place that is good. And this Sunday morning, as we remember a stone rolled away and the pain of that Friday and Saturday have given way to something strange and valuable, an empty tomb, my hope is for our city that we find more empty tombs. Christ is risen, Albuquerque. Christ is risen, Heights First Church. He's risen indeed. And today, we have hope.